Hi, I'm Jason Inman.
And I'm Ashley Victoria Robinson.
And welcome to Crisis Club! This is the series where we're going to explain Crisis on Infinite Earths by every single issue. This time, we're talking about Crisis on Infinite Earths number 11. So welcome to Crisis Club. This is your first time around. Boy, are you going to be confused. That's all I'm going to say. So there will be spoilers for this comic book series. If you haven't read it, you're going to be really confused. This is part 11. What are you doing here? Okay, issue 11 is called Aftershock. It was written and edited by Marv Wolfman, penciled by George Perez with inks by Jerry Ordway, lettered by John Costanza, colored by Anthony Tolan, and this was published in February of 1986. Ashley.
Yes.
Start us off. Let's talk about this cover, but before I have you talk about the cover, in the trade, they lose the trade dressing. But if you look at the original single
issues. I had
issues,
no idea this was a cover. I just thought these were panels.
See, now here's the difference.
I thought this was a backup.
So that is the trade paperback. This is the single issues on Comixology right now. If you look up here, they kept the trade dress, which has the DC celebratory
in the numbers.
50. Up there, which is very interesting. I think looks really, really cool.
Sure, right back for the 80th.
Now, Ashley, let's talk about this. Okay, yeah, this is like sort of a series of vignettes, a clip show of everything that happens in this issue on the cover.
Who's the girl with the purple?
I don't know.
Doesn't matter.
Oh, no, it's Amethyst.
Oh, yeah, it is Amethyst, who's been in none of this so far.
She's been in a couple panels.
And then shows up.
Yeah. But she hasn't been a major player.
But I'll tell you what my favorite thing about the cover is we got to Robin and Huntress down at the bottom. I actually really like this story. I think it's very interesting. Yeah, everything on the cover is what happens here. We also finally get a return of Harbinger.
By the way,
I'm very excited about.
Favorite cameo on this cover. I pointed out Starro last time.
Cosmic Treadmill?
No, in the bottom left-hand corner, I believe that's Alfred on the cover.
In the bottom left?
Bottom left-hand corner,
there's
I don't know.
There's a woman in the bottom left-hand corner.
Oh, so you can't see it on the the trade sucks. Look, right here, this in the left-hand corner, that's Alfred.
Whoever this production artist is.
Right there, Alfred.
Alfred is not.
Yeah, so look, you can scan, I don't know if you can push on this, our editor, Adam, but the digital issue, you can see Alfred to the left of Zatanna.
Yeah, I was like, I thought it was Zatanna. Great. There's two Robins on this cover, so I'm here for it. The rebirth of the universe is summed up again, even though we just read it. Much more beautifully, I would say, here. I really love this pink panel in the middle with that classic 80s pink color.
Ashley, before you turn past the first page, there's a little planet on the first page. The universe is reborn.
Earth?
Yeah, what's the name of that planet?
Earth?
Incorrect! Incorrect, Ashley.
Krypton?
If you know about the DC Comics continuity, this is now...
That's North America.
No. Well, yeah, it is. This is New Earth.
Oh, go suck an egg.
Well, this is the reason why I'm going to bring it up, because this starts...
Yes.
This issue starts New Earth. New Earth is the Earth that existed in DC Comics continuity from about 1986 to about 2011, because before then it was considered Earth 1.
Oh, and not Earth Prime.
Nope, Earth 1. And then...
I think we just illustrated the necessity of this event.
Yes, yes. And then, get ready, after Flashpoint and the New 52, that's when it's renamed Earth Prime.
Okay.
One, I think that's all stupid, but...
It's all Earth.
Well, DC's continuity is so messy because they've rebooted so many times that sometimes that's the only way that you can divide up, like, which part of the Superman's history are you talking about? I'm talking about New Earth Superman. Oh, okay.
I just want to take the Grant Morrison approach and embrace it's all in continuity. All of it happened.
So I just want to distinguish that we are technically...
New Earth.
This is the first appearance of New Earth in DC Comics history.
Let's talk about the Daily Star.
You mean the Daily Planet?
No, I mean the Daily Star.
He thinks it's the Daily Star because on New Earth there is no Daily Star.
I love that. Also, the Daily Star is a piece of Superman lore that I think is pretty much lost.
Do you want to explain it to everybody?
Post this to the ages. The Daily Star was the OG newspaper that Clark Kent worked at that later evolved into the Daily Planet.
Yes.
But the Daily Star was preserved on Earth 2 and in other continuities for a long time, and post-Crisis is largely forgotten. So
yeah.
I just like, I know that reference is timely here, but for me it was a very nostalgic reference.
Yes, and I will say that I love, by the way, I gotta point out when Clark Kent wakes up, 344 Clinton Street is the classic street number of Clark Kent's apartment in comic book history, so I love that. But I also love that, again, Earth 2 Superman in his continuity became the editor-in-chief.
He walks into Perry White's office.
Is a perfect, but I love it. Perry White's like, who are you, son? What are you doing here? Ha! You know?
I also love that, like, young Clark Kent is like, that's my uncle, Clark. And everyone's like, you're right. Sure.
Look, it's comic books. You're just going to go with it.
This is fine.
You're just going to go with it. Also, first appearance of New Earth Perry, New Earth Lois, New Earth Jimmy.
Still wearing a bow tie.
We're going to talk a lot. I think I'm going to save it for part 12, but we're going to talk a lot about the divide. Because this is the first, or technically this is the second time, but this is the first time in modern history that we like put a giant wall in Superman and said everything before didn't happen.
Yeah, Superman also says curiouser and curiouser. That's the young, hot Superman making the most basic white girl Alice in Wonderland reference of all time. There's a couple other literary references that happen in these two issues, but they're all the really obvious one, and that's fun.
But we should talk about
Jay Garrick,
the story part. We're the story point that the characters that were at the dawn of time all think that nothing has changed. They still think that this is that combined Earth of the five different Earths. Remember the big plot point in the last six issues. So
this is the unraveling of that understanding.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But yes, we get to Jay Garrick, and this is the first time that introduced the idea that Central City and Keystone City were combined.
Sister City.
Actually, do you know why that's significant? Do you know how it was in the previous continuity?
Nope.
Okay.
I don't.
Keystone City on Earth 2 was the home to Jay Garrick. Central City in Earth 1 was the home to Barry Allen.
Oh, so they didn't exist on the same Earth?
No.
I thought they were always sister cities.
No.
Like your Kansas cities.
No, this is the thing that made them the Kansas City two cities across the river.
I like that a lot. I also like that, I think what they did with Jay Garrick here is really clever, that Jay Garrick exists on this Earth, but he's not super.
Yep.
I think that's a really, really interesting fix. I also think, man, his wife.
He is super. He has powers.
But nobody here knows that he was the Flash.
Yes, exactly, exactly.
The other great thing, specifically about the Jay Garrick storyline, is we get Wally!
And the Cosmic Treadmill. So here's the interesting thing. So they use the Cosmic Treadmill to travel the multiverse, and when they get out there, there ain't nothing.
I love that. I love that it's just like this void.
And when they see the void, that is one of the panels from the cover. Interesting point here, where Earth 2 Superman feels compelled to go out into the blackness
like
and not exist. Reporter does show up, and there's this weird line where Animal Man and Brainiac and all these people are just kind of chilling.
Also, Dolphin is part of, like, ever since Tula's death, they're just like, and Dolphin is here now in her booty shorts.
Yeah, that's a little weird. But basically, all the heroes are kind of stuck in Titan's Tower, kind of all wandering around being like, what happened?
I love how Lady Quark is just so mad that she still exists.
Mm-hmm.
She's so mad about everything.
But we have to talk about the great character. Harbinger shows up on the next page, and because the universe has been reborn, she has her powers.
She has
back.
Also been reborn as an agent of the universe.
Yes. Now let's talk about Earth 2 Robin and Earth 2 Huntress.
I just think Helena Wayne, and I said this on our Geek History lesson on Huntress, is peak Huntress.
Yep.
She's Huntress perfected. I like her much better than the Bert and Ellie version. But Robin and Huntress are caught up in not understanding why their apartments don't exist, their phone numbers don't exist, their parents don't exist, their mentors don't exist, and they use them to personify, more than Superman, but sort of in an analogous story, what that loss is like to have everyone you love not die, but have never been.
I love the line, the last part of this scene, where Helena says, and this is a great piece of writing by Marv Wolfman, "Don't you understand me, Dick? I don't exist."
Look at how cute Dick looks, too, in his casual uniform with his little gray hairs. I think this scene is so powerful, and I think there's a reason that Helena Wayne, Earth 2 Huntress, does come back later on.
Now, we sort of get a quick history of the DC Universe by Harbinger, where we get the idea that the Freedom Fighters fought in World War II, and that all these characters that were on different Earths are actually just always part of this Earth.
I actually think this is such a cool idea that all of the things that happen on DC Earth here are basically what have happened in our Earth, in our real history, and that this is actually piecemeal from all these different Earths, even though Earth 1 was always more or less a version of our Earths. But I like the idea that, okay, all of the history as we understand it is a composite of all the worlds. I think that's really cool.
And then we get a great moment where Superman gets so concerned that his Lois and his Krypton never existed, and he flies off as like it's unfair.
He's really hung up on the Krypton never existing. I understand being upset about Lois, but I guess I didn't understand him being upset about Krypton as much. That's all.
Yes. Then there's some kind of cosmic-y stuff because Amethyst starts fighting the shadow demons. The shadow demons that should not exist right now.
That we also haven't seen for several issues. So what could it mean?
Yes,
it means we have one more issue to fill.
Yes. So basically, we learn that Amethyst can't stay on this Earth anymore. Dr. Fate takes her home to her Earth, and we tie over into that issue. But we get some interesting moments here where the Earth 2 Wonder Woman goes to Paradise Island. And Hippolyta's like, who the hell are you?
You're also visibly older than me.
Now, the greatest thing I think happens in the next issue where Power Girl is trying to figure out, because again, Power Girl is an anomaly of Crisis on Infinite
Earths. On the next page, not on the next issue.
Yes, my bad. Power Girl is an anomaly because she is the Earth 2 Supergirl, but somehow she exists and people remember her. And then Batman and Robin, Jason Todd Robin,
Jason Todd.
And they, of course, have done some detectiving. And they bring up a very interesting point here. They were like, oh, we've done some investigating. It seems like most people have survived, but now there's only one Joker, one Riddler, and one Penguin. What is he talking about there? Well, he's talking about that in the Golden Age, in the Silver Age, it was kind of assumed that those characters were different Penguins, different Riddlers, different Jokers. That is sort of what Geoff Johns is sort of working on in his comic series that will probably never publish, Three Jokers. But then there's such a great scene where Lex Luthor doesn't remember one single thing about Crisis on Infinite Earths.
Yep. It's just fun to give that moment to Luthor because he is of such supreme intelligence in this world. And he's basically like, yo, leave me alone. I'm not falling for your trick. I know what you're here to do. And he couldn't be more wrong.
Yes. And at the moment in this issue where all the heroes are like, well, I guess this is the new, this is what's going to happen. Suddenly Pariah goes, ah! And then the Earth shifts to the antimatter universe. And the antimatter is still alive. And he goes, welcome to my universe. Welcome to your doom. That's my antimatter.
You do see his eyes sparking like Michael Myers. Yes. Like, he never really dies.
And then we get a tease that the double side finale is going to be called The Final Crisis.
Little did they know that that title would be lifted and given to Grant Morrison in about 30 years.
Yep. Real quick before we move on, fun facts. Ashley, I want you to know that this is New Earth history, as we said. In Earth 1, Superman now states that he found a reference to Kara dying in battle, but in fact, in this New Earth continuity, there's no Supergirl.
Yeah.
So how can he remember? Also, the cosmic treadmill is destroyed in this issue, but later on in the Flash solo series led by Wally West, it shows up.
Yeah.
All right, so let's go straight into the rating of this issue based on a scale of 1 to 5 Earths, 5 being the best. Ashley, what are you going to give this issue?
I liked this issue a lot.
Yep.
Honestly, like, not a ton happened in it in terms of, like, different events. It's a lot more expository, but it blows out our new world and our new status quo in such an interesting way, and it hangs the hat of that on these incredible emotional beats. Yeah. I think after issues 9 and 10, it's great. It's practically perfect in every way. And of course, there's beautiful art on top of it. I'm going to give it 5 out of 5. I loved this issue. How about you?
I'm going to give this a 5 out of 5 as well. I think couching it in the idea that all these characters, what they think they know is wrong now, and getting to live a little bit in the new Earth, I thought was really great, especially couching it in Earth 2 Superman. I thought that was a really, really nice way to do it. So if you want to read more before we get to the final issue, here's the official reading order of Crisis. It comes from the official Crisis on the Infinite Earths companion. So you read Crisis on Infinite Earths issue 11, then you read Amethyst volume 2 number 13, that's where Dr. Fate and Amethyst went, Green Lantern volume 2 number 196, Green Lantern volume 2 number 197, and then it's the final issue, baby, Crisis on Infinite Earths number 12.
I know this issue has twice as many pages.
Twice as many pages?
And let me tell you, friends, you feel them.
This is the end. We're here, guys. Part 12 of Crisis Club. Issue 12 is called Final Crisis. It was written and edited by Marv Wolfman, penciled by George Perez, inks by Jerry Ordway, lettered by John Costanza, colored by Anthony Tolan, and it was published in March of 1986. Let's talk about this cover. We're looking down, very downward angle. We're in the middle of a city, and then out in the middle of the city, the anti-monitor is pushing towards the camera.
He's so tall.
And all the heroes. This is why I love George Perez. Looking at this cover, all the heroes are like is flying towards the anti-monitor. There's a bunch in his fist.
Batman's being squished.
There's a bunch of different stuff here, but it's an amazing perspective. It's so detailed. This is the image I think of that pops up in my head when somebody says Crisis on Infinite Earths.
This cover?
Yep.
Wow. I love the, in the lower, what is space, right-hand corner, how Shazam is trying to pry up the anti-monitor's thumb to get Aquaman out of the way. He's like, too many Aqua people have died, I will save you.
There is a very interesting person on this cover that I love.
I don't know, they might not be on my version of the cover.
Do you notice Elongated Man?
Yes.
Yes, he's
wrapped around.
He's wrapped around the fist, and then he's around his head, and then his feet are like underneath Power Girl, which I think was very clever.
People who watch our Flash reviews know that I try not to.
Well, a lot of people might think that that's Plastic Man because it has the same colors, but that's Elongated Man's 80s costume.
I don't think Plastic Man is in this.
Not really, no.
So, Elongated Man is, though. Ralph gets some good facey-face time.
Yes. So there's a bunch of Brainiac stuff in the beginning that I don't really want to talk about.
Or Dolphin, inexplicably.
Yeah, there's a bunch of...
Oh, Animal Man does say in this opening sequence, he does say where no man has gone before Captain Warp Factor 6. So clearly... Mr. Wolfman with his excellent taste. Star Trek fan.
Well, we already talked about this. There is an earlier alien species that was, they were named after the Sete Alphians or something like that. I forgot that reference.
We also have a reference to the Soviet Union being under attack, which threw me for a real loop because I forgot that the Soviet Union existed. And other than the art style, there's very little to tie this to a specific time period, but that one, that reference definitely, definitely does.
Actually, if you're okay with it, there's a bunch of cosmic-y nonsense and shadow demons and stuff.
So
and
pretty.
I want to skip all the way ahead
to
Darkseid.
Okay.
Now, Darkseid has appeared in this series before.
Yes, we should discuss some examples.
Very briefly, he was like kind of talking about Desaad was like, oh, do you want to be a part of this? And he's like, no, I do not. In his Michael Ironside voice, because that's the voice of Darkseid. So they show up to like sort of recruit him, Adam Strange and Animal Man and Rip Hunter. And it's kind of Rip Hunter's idea to go recruit Darkseid, right?
He's thick. In this panel.
Yes.
He's a big man.
Yes.
It's funny, the page after he appears, we get Hawk and Dove, and I truly thought Dove was always a lady. This is the issue that taught me that was not the case.
Actually, this is the original Hawk and Dove when they were brothers, Hank and Dawn.
They weren't even lovers? That's no fun.
Nope. This is the issue where Dawn dies, and this sets up the female Dove later showing up. But before that happens, this specific event later leads on to the not the next DC big event crossover, but I think the second one, because I think there's Legends in between them. Armageddon 2001, where Hawk goes crazy because his brother was killed in the crisis.
You would like to regress Armageddon 2001 Club.
No.
You could do so in the comment section.
No. Anything you want to talk about here, actually?
I love any time we get Lana and Lois working together as reporters. I also love that Lois is like gets too overwhelmed to do her job at one point, which I find very funny. Like she kind of gets the vapors, and I always think of Lois as being like the tough lady reporter. So I think they're using that to try and tell us how crazy everything is that Lois is like, this is too much for me to handle.
Let's talk about all the heroes on the antimatter world of Quard. It's now a barren wasteland, and Wally is there, and this is the first time that Wally has heard about because the death of his mentor, because the antimatter said he killed the Flash, and he sees the last Flash of Barry. If you remember back in the issue where Barry dies, he sees Wally really quickly. And then
Batman v Superman comes in and steals the scene.
And then Wally runs over to the Psycho Pirate, seeing him pull out the costume of the Flash, and this confirms that Barry Allen is dead.
Yeah. Well,
now, you love Wally West. Let's talk about this a little bit.
This is great. I didn't realize that this is, like, over the course of this issue, Barry's death is revealed to everyone else, and Wally is literally like, I'm the Flash now.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it.
Because Barry died alone, so nobody knows.
And it brokered no arguments. It brooks no arguments from anyone. Like, he just puts the costume on and he becomes the Flash. If this happened now in modern comics, people would be like, you can't be the Flash. You can't do this. And I love that this happens in an era where he's still able to, but this page proves, without Mark Waid, without the modern series telling us that Wally's the fastest, why Wally is the most interesting mm-hmm. character to ever be the Flash.
I love the line, Marv Wolfman's dialogue here on this page, where he says, Barry says, it really is over now, isn't it? Oh, Lord Barry, I'll miss you. Oh, how I will miss you. Mm-hmm. When he's being handed the Flash ring.
Yeah.
And then there's a giant splash page where the anti-monitor is like, you whimpering fool, it is already too late.
He finally looks like our action figure.
This is the day the universe dies.
He looks amazing. And little Superboy's down there like, oh no, I'm gonna die.
Then Superman's girlfriend, Lori Lamaris,
I wrote
people.
That down!
did you think I wouldn't recognize as Lori Lamaris?
Oh no, but I just wanted to be like, Jason, Lori, you're the only reason I know who Lori Lamaris is, so I was so happy.
Look, if you don't know, in his college days, Clark Kent journeyed around the world and had an under-the-sea girlfriend.
Torrid love affair.
With Lori Lamaris. Yeah. Actually, one of the funniest things is there's a joke somewhere in the John Byrne run where Clark Kent comes back and talks to Pa and is like talking about Lois and all his girl troubles. And I believe Pa says something to the effect of like, well, it can't be as difficult as dating a fish girl, can it, boy?
Well, in one of the DC animated movies when he brings Lois over for dinner,
yeah.
Ma brings up Lori Lamaris.
It's in the Death of Superman animated movie.
Yeah, there you go. Not that she's a fish woman, but just that she is someone that Superman had dated. So she's kind of a weird joke.
I think the line in that movie is something like, oh, what about that girl, the Olympic swimmer?
That's right. Yeah. But she showed up. I've never seen her before. Mm. I didn't know what she looked like. I don't know why she has a gun, but she showed up and I was like, oh,
80s.
I mean, she has a really great costume that any drag queen would kill for and a fishtail. So good on you, Clark. Good on you.
I'm gonna talk about here the idea of Dr. Occult and the original Green Lantern, Alan Scott here, trying to will and lock concentration. Do you know why Alan Scott Green Lantern is doing this with Dr. Occult?
Because he's magic based?
Exactly, that's what I wanted to bring up. In case you don't know, Alan Scott's
OG Green Lantern
is a part of an element called the Star Heart. It's what gives him his powers when he's not Green Lantern later on. But yes, he is a magical-based superhero, not a technology-based superhero.
Which is funny because I would argue that all Green Lanterns are magic. It's just space-branded magic. And this double-page spread as well, we talk a lot about panel composition, we talk a lot about layouts. Again, if you want to see, like, this puts all modern double-page spreads to absolute shame. I can't imagine how long this took to draw. We get a great Mary Marvel shows up and is named a couple times here. I just love every time Mary Marvel shows up. She's so wonderful. Lois and two other reporters, including Roy Raymond, show back up, and then we go to space.
Yes, and it's just, again, you guys might be wondering, like, well, why aren't you talking about this? It's because it's a big fight. It's a big punchy fight. There's one moment in here where they think the anti-monitor's dead, but they bring him back. I love that he says, I cannot be stopped, human.
They literally say, ding dong, the witch is dead.
But there's an interesting point. He kills Wonder Woman. The anti-monitor kills Earth, no. He kills Earth 1.
Oh,
Wonder
I thought
Woman.
It was Earth 2.
No. We still got a reset coming on. The universe is not completely solidified. He burns Earth 1 Wonder Woman away right here at the bottom of the page.
Oh, I assumed it was Earth 2.
And she is dead as dead. No, we're going to talk about Earth 2 Wonder Woman here very specifically because she gets an ending that a lot of the other Earth 2 heroes don't get.
Yeah.
And Earth 2 Wonder Woman technically exists in the new Earth continuity. We're going to talk about how this resets the DC universe a lot. This is going to be a little bit longer Chris Club than normal. The two Supermans are fighting together.
With Lady Quark.
They're doing a bunch of stuff. And then Alex Luthor is like, oh, my eyes. My Jerry curl. And then he suddenly blasts the anti-monitor with a giant beam because Darkseid takes control of him and channels through him.
Darkseid has been watching this whole time.
Yes.
Now, the eyes of Alex
this is something that is repeated in future DC storylines. Now, for years, I always wondered, like, well, why in our worlds at war does Darkseid take control of Tempest, a magic-based unit, and then blast through his eyes? Why in Infinite Crisis, the sequel to this storyline, does this character get taken control by Darkseid and splats? It's because they were homaging this very moment from Crisis on Infinite Earths. So Alexander's Luthor's eye lines basically burn the anti-monitor's armor away. This is the second time this has happened. And then he screams, Superman, I will not die until you die with me.
Mm-hmm.
Now, actually, I want to talk about this big moment. We get a giant page where Superman says, "No more. Nothing matters any longer. I want to see him destroyed. I have had enough." I kind of imagine the James T. Kirk search for Spock Star Trek 3 line, "I have had enough!" And he punches the anti-monitor and kills
into
him.
Into oblivion. And there's some, well, yeah, maybe he kills him.
No, he kills him. Now, the original Superman, the first superhero
ever,
ends the crisis on Infinite Earths. Ashley, how do you feel about that?
Perfect.
Yeah, is there any other hero that deserves this?
I mean, I'm sure you could have found a narrative reason to give it to whoever you wanted, but I love this. It tells you a lot about the tremendous amount of research and respect, which I think is evident from jump that's gone into this book, but the fact that they do give it to Earth One Superman instead of modern Superman or, again, any Batman, who would have been the fan favorite choice for this. I think it's tremendous that OG Superman gets that moment.
Although we will get a little bit of piece of moment. Alexander Luthor gives the Earth to Superman like, "Hey, I saved Lois inside of me." And
yeah, I mean, you know what? The Lex Luthor's always got a weird relationship with Lois.
Yeah, that's true. So here is the moment where Superboy Prime, Superman of Earth 2, Lois of Earth 2, and Alexander Luthor of Earth 3 sort of go off into a paradise dimension separate from the universe.
A lot of people think this is heaven or heaven analog.
It kind of is. Mm-hmm. Now, just to let you know, this directly ties into, I will not tell you now, into Infinite Crisis. So if it is out there, it is the will of the multiverse that all of you out there want us to do a club, because I think we're definitely doing another club for next year. If you want us to do the sequel to Crisis on Infinite Earths, we're going to be talking about this page a lot. A lot, a lot, a lot, a lot.
If we do Infinite Crisis Club.
If we do Infinite Crisis Club. Okay, so actually, the very next page, we talked about Wonder Woman. This is the explanation of how Wonder Woman was killed, because she was punched and burned into existence. She goes back to her original clay.
Yeah.
But
that's cute. That means she don't die.
Yes. If you look on this page, Earth 2.
The final panel of this page is one of my favorites.
Wonder Woman. Zeus of Olympus brings Wonder Woman, Earth 2, and her husband, because Earth 2, Wonder Woman, marries Steve Trevor, to Olympus of Earth 1.
And makes her a goddess.
So technically, Earth 2 Wonder Woman exists in the new Earth universe.
Yeah, so when you all got mad that she was the god of war, she's been a god for a long time. I think just the panel of her where she has ascended to her true godhood and she has kind of a Demeter-style crown is so beautiful. And it's really like, that's what I want for Wonder Woman. She deserves everything. But then on the next page, we get a bunch of other wrap-ups. We get, of course, this Batman and Robin are having the saddest funeral of all time for everyone.
It's kind of a cop-out. They say the bodies of Robin of Earth 2, the Huntress,
yeah, it's really
and
lame,
Cole
actually
were never found, which is a little bit lame.
What's important about this page?
Yes, is the bottom.
It's the bottom sequence.
Ashley, take us through it.
Flash. So, I don't know if you guys know this about Wally West. Wally West had all these problems with being the Flash and with his speed. He had cancer at one point and he had to stop being the Flash.
Do you know why they did that?
No, because they were stupid.
Well, because there was this idea, and they sort of do this in Young Justice, which I don't like. There was this idea pre-Crisis that they didn't want Kid Flash to be able to be as fast as Barry.
Yeah, so Wally was never as fast as Barry.
So they made him sick, and they made him, they made this thing where, like, if you run faster than the speed of sound, your heart's gonna explode. It's all stupid.
Yeah, very, like, an excuse to not have him surpass his mentor, which is fine, but they could have done it in a better way than they did, ultimately.
Yep.
Here, because of the events of Crisis and because of cosmic nonsense, he's fine, he's great, he's more powerful than ever. He'll probably be faster than Barry, but they don't confirm that for another decade or so. He gets Barry's Flash ring to remember him by, and he steps into the costume, and then he's the Flash.
This is the first appearance of Wally West as the Flash.
Until Flashpoint.
Until 2011. No, until Flash Rebirth, which is like 2009.
If you vote for Flashpoint Club, I will never forgive you.
We're not even going to make it an option. Let's talk about this next page where we have Lady Quark, Pariah, and Harbinger as sort of the outsiders who were, because at this point,
Harbinger looks like every Barbie doll I owned in the 90s.
Lady Quark, remember, is her only survivor of that world. Yeah. So she's a weirdo outsider of the multiverse. But these are like three of the only people left.
Why does anyone want to hang out with Pariah? Pariah sucks.
I don't know. That remember the Crisis on Infinite Earths, except for two other people. We're going to find out who the next person is in the other page, but there's one other character who, Ashley, I don't know if you know. We've talked about it on Geek History Lesson, but I'll see if you remember it. But what do you think? I think this is a nice little scene. We get two reveals. The Great Disaster, Jack Kirby's thing of Commandy, it's revealed that in this new Earth, it doesn't happen. This series also sets up the very fun 1980 series, Hex!
Jonah Hex!
Where Jonah Hex goes to the future.
He's blonde in this panel, which I think is a mistake. That's fine.
It's meant to be brown, but Hex, Jonah Hex goes to the future, and he fights aliens.
Is that the Jimmy Palmiotti series?
No, it's an 80s series where they sent Jonah Hex into the future. It's terrible and awesome at the same time.
Okay.
We're definitely not doing Hex Club, so don't ask for it.
I don't care for Pariah, but I like their little outsiders club, little meeting thing. I think that's very sweet. And it is so super 80s that we look up in the sky and a picture of the monitor superimposes himself. But it's really gorgeous.
Yep.
So I can forgive it.
And then we get the epilogue with Psycho Pirate.
Qu'est-ce que c'est?
Psycho Pirate remembering the multiverse and
of
telling everybody.
Of course he would.
We should talk about the aftermath of this issue.
Okay.
Ashley, let's take you straight into the ratings based on a scale of 1 to 5 Earths, the final issue, Crisis on Infinite Earths, and please talk a little bit about this so I have enough time to pull up my research for the aftermath.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I actually liked this issue more talking through it with you now. When I read it...
But wait a minute, Ashley. You can't change your opinion ever.
I know.
That's not how the internet works.
This is the internet.
Yes.
Reading it, I actually thought it was kind of a slog.
I did too.
And kind of boring because all the exciting stuff already happened. There were moments that I really genuinely enjoyed. The Wally West argument obviously like sings to my soul and I like that a lot, but it felt a little anticlimactic after the 11 issues that predated it.
And let's talk about it. Issue 11 is a pretty amazing, almost epilogue.
Great. You could have ended with that and it would have been. I like the beat with the heaven dimension. That's really nice. It's really nice what it says about DC and DC's respect for their history and things like that. I think this could have just been it didn't need to be a double issue. I'm sorry, Marv and George.
A little long.
Or it could have been 30 pages. It didn't need to be 48 pages. It was very long, and it feels as long as it is. And I said that at the beginning. I'm gonna give it 4 out of 5.
Okay.
Because I think it's really good, but it is not perfect. And the last issue was almost perfect. So just by comparison, I don't think it's fair to give it a 5. How about you?
I agree. It's kind of bittersweet. Issue 11 is almost a really good ending. I kind of feel that like issue 11 and 12 should have been combined. And I kind of think that the battle with the anti-monitor should have been all in issue 11. And I kind of think issue 12, because there's a lot of the setup of the new Earth that is kind of done in pages or panels, like the panel where they're just like, we couldn't find their bodies.
Yeah.
I think issue 12 should have been entirely in the new DC universe.
I agree.
And it should have set it up for us.
The new status quo.
Yeah, instead of being like the big fight. I think maybe the last page of 11 should have been Earth 2 Superman. Bow! And then them going to the Earth to their heaven dimension. And then I think we should have lived in the new DC universe, especially since this was originally created as a celebration of the DC universe. So because of that, and I do agree, it's too long.
It's too long.
And so I'm going to give it a 4 out of 5 as well.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have to talk about the aftermath. We have to talk about this new DC universe. This is the first comic book reboot in the history of comic history. Here's what happened after this, okay? So many DC characters post-crisis had their entire history rebooted. Wonder Woman was relaunched from ground zero by George Perez, Len Wein, and Greg Potter. Superman was revisioned from ground zero in the limited series The Man of Steel by John Byrne. Brilliant series. And his titles were rebooted. It was retitled The Adventures of Superman. Adventures of Superman was sent away for a new series called Superman. Batman was minimally affected by the reboot.
Like with every reboot, honestly.
And also neither of his comics were relaunched. He got to keep his numbering.
Mm-hmm.
Wally West replaced Barry Allen the Flash. The Justice League was rebooted, and this was the start of the history where it was said that the original adventure of the Justice League did not include Superman, did not include Batman, and that the Justice League was five members, Barry Allen Flash, Hal Jordan Green Lantern, Martian Manhunter,
Wonder Woman,
Aquaman. No, this is the
Black
change.
Canary?
Black Canary. This is where that Justice League happened. And it was said that Wonder Woman joined later because George Perez started where Wonder Woman had never met the Justice League. Because in that new series, it's their first time coming to man's world and the Justice League already exists.
It's a good series, by the way.
And then also, this is where it said that Superman and Batman were temporary members.
Yeah.
Not permanent members.
Auxiliary members.
Yes. And then, of course, this led into Barry Allen the Flash. The Fawcett character, this is the start of Shazam being part of the DC universe.
You meant Wally West the Flash.
Sorry, my bad.
I just didn't want anyone to be...
Green Lantern was re-envisioned. Hawkman was re-envisioned. And the Suicide Squad was re-envisioned for this year. And this also, this was the first time that DC beat Marvel in direct market sales since before the creation of Marvel.
Wow.
So, Crisis on Infinite Earths.
Good job, DC.
Did work. So that's some of the aftermath I want to talk about. And also, I'm just going to be honest, this led into my favorite version of DC, the DC. This, the New Earth DC Universe from 1985 to 2011 is my favorite DC.
Me too, universe. Absolutely, 100%.
And I'm excited to end this journey of Crisis Club, man.
Ooh.
It's been a long road. We did a lot of crises. Any final thoughts on the overall, just the series of Crisis on Infinite Earths? It's the final Crisis Club episode. What do you think?
Always knew Crisis was very important.
Yes.
We've talked about Crisis endlessly on Geek History Lesson, and this is something that you and I expressed when we were doing our earliest episodes.
Yes.
Trying to read it more critically, trying to come up with talking points, trying to do some research to figure out some of the context and the aftermath of what spilled out of it has really made me appreciate what a true work of literature and art this book is and how incredibly well-crafted it is down to the minutiae. Even the things that I don't like or are not to my taste, I think are done with deliberation and with thought and with skill. And I really, really think this is an incredible, incredible book.
Yeah, I mean, the one thing that has been very apparent from doing Crisis Club is that this comic book series changed comic books. And they say that a lot of comic book events, and this one literally did.
No, this is the one.
And the fact that, the great thing about this is that this truly did change comic books in 1985, is that reading this now, in 2019, 30 years later, 34 years later, it still is good. There were some issues that felt a little slow.
Mm-hmm.
There were some issues that felt dated, but I would say overall on the whole, if I were to do the whole series, give this whole series a rating, I'd probably give this series a 4 out of 5. Like,
uh-huh.
It's that good.
Mm-hmm. And yeah. I will say, my opinion, so don't come for me, I don't think Marvel has ever created a crossover or an event that has matched this.
No,
I don't think so. I think in this case, I think Crisis / DC is king.
I'm going to say this. The closest that Marvel has ever gotten is Age of Apocalypse.
Agreed.
And the only reason they got that close is because they interrupted the X-Men line for 4 months.
Yeah.
And kind of didn't tell anybody that it was going to happen. So again,
but they did it well.
But if you were an X-Men fan reading the X-Men titles, like suddenly you were picking up X-Force, and then the next month it was like X-Man, or I can't remember the title it was. Like you were just like, what? Factor X? What is this? And then it was that was the norm for four months. So that had a huge impact. But that's
Age of Apocalypse Club?
But that's the closest one. That's the thing we got to talk about, guys. We had a blast doing this. Thank you so much for being with us on this. Thank you so much for our support over at Patreon, patreon.com/Jawin, that this happened, the Crisis Club happened. And yeah, we're looking for the next one. We don't know what it's going to be, but we damn sure want to do another one. So thank you so much for watching this.
Yeah, let us know what you would like to see this turn into going forward in the comments. We're putting on polls.
Yeah.
Because we're going to keep this going because it was awesome, and you were all awesome coming on this journey with us.
We're totally looking for suggestions, and we're totally looking for how we're going to be changed by the multiverse, because now we're new Jason and new Ashley.
Oh man.
It's like new Coke. We're in a new world, and we don't know what it's like. It's not as bad as Crystal Pepsi, but it might be. No, it's not. It's better. It's better. We're actually, I think we've turned into Surge, doing a lot of soda references.
I don't understand any of these references.
We've become Pib Extra, if you will. Yeah. Okay.
Extra doctor?
We're in a new world, everybody, and we're so happy that you guys have journeyed through the multiverse with us. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Jason Inman.
I'm Ashley Victoria Robinson.
And for the final time, Crisis Club!